Hello, I welcome you all in our series of lectures on cybersecurity. Today, we are going to learn about operating system security, which forms the integral part of security. In this lecture, we learn about operating system services, types of operating systems, and operating system security. So, let us begin with the topic. Before learning what operating system security is, let us first understand what is operating system and what functions does it perform. Operating system is a software that acts as an interface between the user and the system, that is, between user and the hardware. The operating system OS of a computer is the first software that gets installed on the hard disk, and it remains there even when the computer is turned off. The operating system is also the first software that gets loaded into the computer's memory when it is turned on. Once the operating system is up and running, it performs very critical tasks such as, number one, system management. Without an operating system, your computer would not even start up. The first task of the operating system is to manage the starting up of your computer, also known as booting up. When this happens, the operating system makes sure all the various elements of your computer are working properly. Once the operating system is up and running, you are ready to start using your computer. Perhaps you are writing an essay for school. So, you open up a word processing application. You do some research online, so you open up a web browser. And while you are working, you want to listen to some music, so you launch your music player. So, you are running multiple applications at the same time. This is known as multitasking. We take this for granted on today's computers, but in the early days of computing, a computer system only carried out a single task at a time. While the operating system is multitasking, it is constantly managing system resources. For example, applications require memory to run, and there is only so much memory installed on a computer system. So, let's say you want to include an image into your essay, and you start using photo editing software to work on a high quality photograph. This may take a fair bit of memory. You don't want the photo editing to be terribly slow, but you also don't want your music to stop playing. So, the operating system tries to balance the memory needs of all the applications that are running. System management also includes routine maintenance tasks such as file management, defragmenting disk to optimize hard disk drive, and keeping track of power supply. Number two, communication services. The operating system establishes an internet connection so you can surf the web or send emails. We take being online almost for granted, but there are a lot of protocols at work behind the scenes to make sure you stay connected. The operating system makes sure you don't have to worry about managing these protocols by yourself. Every time you visit a website, download a song, or send an email, your computer interacts with a computer network that stretches across the globe. Your operating system manages your connections, such as Ethernet and Wi-Fi connections, and ensures all the communications with the network occur seamlessly. Number three, security. There are numerous security threats to your computer, in particular various types of malware, which is short for malicious software. This includes computer viruses, which can interfere with the normal operations of your computer. Viruses can be very harmful and result in loss of data or system crashes. The operating system of a computer has a number of built-in tools to protect against security threats, including the use of virus scanning utilities and setting up a firewall to block suspicious network activity. One of the most common ways to get a computer virus is by email. If you have received an email message from someone you don't know with an unknown file attachment, be careful about opening up that file since it may just contain a virus or other malicious software. While the operating system has a number of built-in security tools, you may need additional software to set up the best protection, in particular virus scanning software. These types of utilities expand the functionality of the operating system. Then number 4, hardware services. The operating system manages all the hardware and peripheral devices of your computer. For example, when you put in a DVD to play a movie, the operating system will start reading the data from the optical drive and launch a movie player. Or when you are saving a file to a USB flash drive, the operating system checks to make sure there is enough space on the drive to store your file. In order to communicate with the hardware devices, the operating system uses drivers. Device drivers are program files that enable the operating system to recognize the hardware device and its properties. Many of these drivers are built into the operating system, but there are so many devices that not all of them may be available. A typical operating system uses plug and play to install a new hardware device. This means that you plug in the device using a cable such as a USB cable, and the operating system will automatically install the right driver and make sure that the device is ready to use. Sometimes, however, you may need to use the installation disk that comes with the device or get a more up-to-date driver online. Now, let us discuss various types of operating systems. Operating systems are there from the very first computer generation. Operating systems keep evolving over the period of time. Let us discuss few of the important types of operating systems which are most commonly used. Number 1, batch operating system. The users of batch operating system do not interact with the computer directly. Each user prepares his job on an offline device like punch cards and submits it to the computer operator. To speed up processing, jobs with similar needs are batched together and run as a group. Thus, the programmers lift their programs with the operator. The operator then sorts programs into batches with similar requirements. Number 2, time sharing operating systems. Time sharing is a technique which enables many people located at various terminals to use a particular computer system at the same time. Time sharing or multitasking is a logical extension of multiprogramming. Processor's time which is shared among multiple users simultaneously is termed as time sharing. The main difference between multi-programmed batch system and time sharing system is that in case of multi-programmed batch systems, objective is to maximize processor use, whereas in time sharing systems, objective is to minimize response time. Multiple jobs are executed by the CPU by switching between them, but the switches occur so frequently that the user can receive an immediate response. For example, in a transaction processing, processor executes each user program in a short burst or quantum of computation. That is, if n users are present, each user can get time quantum. When the user submits the command, the response time is in few seconds at most. Number 3, distributed operating system. Distributed systems use multiple central processors to serve multiple real-time applications and multiple users. Data processing jobs are distributed among the processors according to which one can perform each job most efficiently. The processors communicate with one another through various communication lines such as high-speed buses or telephone lines. These are referred as loosely coupled systems or distributed systems. Processors in a distributed system may vary in size and function. These processors are referred as sites, nodes, computers, and so on. Number 4, network operating system. Network operating system runs on a server and provides server the capability to manage data, users, groups, security, applications, and other networking functions. The primary purpose of the network operating system is to allow shared file and printer access among multiple computers in a network, typically a local area network, a private network, or to the other networks. Examples of network operating systems are Microsoft Windows Server 2003, Microsoft Windows Server 2008, Unix, Linux, Mac operating system, Novell NetWare, and BSD. Next is operating system properties. The very important tasks that operating system handles are, number 1, batch processing. Batch processing is a technique in which operating system collects one program and data together in a batch before processing starts. In it, operating system defines a job which has predefined sequence of commands, programs, and data as a single unit. The operating system keeps a number of jobs in memory and executes them without any mutual information. The jobs are processed in the order of submission, that is, first come, first served fashion. When job completes its execution, its memory is released and the output for the job gets copied into an output spool for later printing or processing. Number 2, multitasking. Multitasking refers to term where multiple jobs are executed by the CPU simultaneously by switching between them. Switches occur so frequently that the users may interact with each program while it is running. Number 3, multiprogramming. When two or more programs are residing in memory at the same time, then sharing the processor is referred to the multiprogramming. Multiprogramming assumes a single shared processor. Multiprogramming increases CPU utilization by organizing jobs so that the CPU always has one to execute. The figure shows the memory layout for a multiprogramming system. Number 4, spooling. Spooling is an acronym for simultaneous peripheral operations online. Spooling refers to putting data of various input-output jobs in a buffer. This buffer is a special area in memory or hard disk which is accessible to input-output devices. Operating system does some activities related to distributed environment such as operating system handles input-output device data spooling as devices have different data access rates. Operating system maintains the spooling buffer which provides a waiting station where data can rest while the slower device catches up. Also, operating system maintains parallel computation because of a spooling process as a computer can perform input-output in parallel fashion. It becomes possible to have the computer read data from a tape, write data to disk, and to write out to a tape printer while it is doing its computing task. So, these are some of the properties of operating system. Now, I think we know what operating system is and what it does. We also now know different types of operating systems. Now, let us move on to operating system security. Operating system security is the process of ensuring operating system integrity, confidentiality, and availability. Operating system security refers to specified steps or measures used to protect the operating system from threats, viruses, worms, malware, or remote hacker intrusions. Operating system security encompasses all preventive control techniques which safeguard any computer assets capable of being stolen, edited, or deleted if operating system security is compromised. Operating system security encompasses many different techniques and methods which ensure safety from threats and attacks. It allows different applications and programs to perform required tasks and stop unauthorized interference. Operating system security may be approached in many ways, including adherence to the points such as performing regular operating system patch updates, installing updated antivirus engines and software, scrutinizing all incoming and outgoing network traffic through a firewall, creating secure accounts with required privileges only, that is user management. Security refers to providing a protection system to computer system resources such as CPU, memory, disk, software programs, and most importantly data or information stored in the computer system. If a computer program is run by unauthorized user, then he or she may cause severe damage to computer or data stored in it. So, a computer system must be protected against unauthorized access or malicious access to system memory, viruses, worms, etc. Now, we are going to discuss various operating system related security concepts. First is user authentication. If a system cannot authenticate a user, then authenticating that a message came from that user is pointless. Thus, a major security problem for operating system is user authentication. The protection system depends on the ability to identify the programs and processes currently executing, which in turn depends on the ability to identify each user of the system. A user normally identifies herself. How do we determine whether a user's identity is authentic? Generally, a user authentication is based on one or more or three things: the user's possession of something, usually a key or a card, the user's knowledge of something, a user identifier or a password, or an attribute of the user such as fingerprint, retina pattern, or signature. Then is passwords. The most common approach to authenticating a user identity is the use of passwords. When the user identifies herself by user ID of account name, she is asked for a password. If the user supplied password matches the password stored in the system assumes that the account is being accessed by the owner of that account. Passwords are often used to protect objects in the computer system in the absence of more complete protection schemes. They can be considered a special case of either keys or capabilities. For instance, a password could be associated with each resource, such as a file. Whenever a request is made to use the resource, the password must be given. If the password is correct, access is granted. Different passwords may be associated with different access rights. For example, different passwords may be used for reading files, appending files, and updating files. In practice, most systems require only one password for a user to gain full rights, although more passwords theoretically would be more secure. Such systems tend not to be implemented due to classic trade-off between security and convenience. If security makes something inconvenient, then the security is frequently bypassed or otherwise circumvented. Next is password vulnerabilities. Passwords are extremely common because they are easy to understand and use. Unfortunately, passwords can often be guessed, accidentally exposed, sniffed, or illegally transferred from an authorized user to an unauthorized one, as we show next. There are two common ways to guess a password. One way is for the intruder, either human or program, to know the user or to have information about the user. all too frequently people use obvious information such as the names of their cats or spouses as their passwords. The other way is to use brute force, trying enumeration or all possible combinations of valid password characters, letters, numbers and punctuations on some systems until the password is found. Short passwords are especially vulnerable to this method. For example, a 4-decimal password provides only 10,000 variations. On average, guessing 5,000 times would produce a correct hit. A program that could try a password every millisecond would take only about 5 seconds to guess a 4-digit password. Enumeration is less successful where systems allow longer passwords that include both uppercase and lowercase letters, along with numbers and all punctuation characters. Of course, users must take advantage of the large password space and must not, for example, use only lowercase letters. In addition to being guessed, passwords can be exposed as a result of visual or electronic monitoring. An intruder can look over the shoulder of a user, called shoulder surfing, when the user is logging in and can learn the password easily by watching the keyboard. Alternatively, anyone with access to the network on which a computer resides can seamlessly add a network monitor, allowing her to watch all data being transferred on the network, called sniffing, including user IDs and passwords. Encrypting the data stream containing the password solves this problem. Even such a system could have passwords stolen, however. For example, if a file is used to contain the passwords, it could be copied for off-system analysis. Or consider a Trojan horse program installed on the system that captures every keystroke before sending it onto the application. Exposure is a particularly severe problem if the password is written down where it can be read or lost. As we shall see, some systems forces users to select how to remember or long passwords, which may cause a user to record the password or to reuse it. As a result, such systems provide much less security than systems that allow users to select easy passwords. The final type of password compromise, illegal transfer, is the result of human nature. Most computer installations have a rule that forbids users to share accounts. This rule is sometimes implemented for accounting reasons, but is often aimed at improving security. For instance, suppose one user ID is shared by several users and a security breach occurs from that user ID. It is impossible to know who was using the ID at the time the break occurred or even whether the user was an authorized one. With one user per user ID, any user can be questioned directly about use of the account. In addition, the user might notice something different about the account and detect the break-in. Sometimes, users break account sharing rules to help friends or to circumvent accounting, and this behavior can result in a system's being accessed by unauthorized users, possibly harmful ones. Passwords can be either generated by the system or selected by a user. System-generated passwords may be difficult to remember and thus users may write them down. As mentioned, however, user-selected passwords are often easy to guess, the user's name or favorite car, for example. Some systems will check a proposed password for ease of guessing or cracking before accepting it. At some sites, administrators occasionally check user passwords and notify a user if his password is easy to guess. Some systems also change passwords, forcing users to change their passwords at regular intervals. For example, every 3 months, for instance, this method is not foolproof either because users can easily toggle between two passwords. The solution, as implemented on some systems, is to record a password history for each user. For instance, the system could record the last n passwords and not allow their reuse. Several variants on these simple password schemes can be used. For example, the password can be changed more frequently. In the extreme, the password is changed from session to session. A new password is selected either by the system or by the user at the end of each session, and that password must be used for the next session. In such a case, even if a password is misused, it can be used only once. When the legitimate user tries to use a now invalid password at the next session, he discovers the security violation. Steps can then be taken to repair the breached security. Next is one-time passwords. To avoid the problems of password sniffing and shoulder surfing, a system could use a set of paired passwords. When a session begins, the system randomly selects and presents one part of a password pair. The user must supply the other part. In this system, the user is challenged and must respond with a correct answer to that challenge. This approach can be generalized to use of an algorithm as a password. The algorithm might be an integer function, for example. The system selects a random integer and presents it to the user. The user applies the function and replies with the correct result. The system also applies the function. If the two results match, access is allowed. Such algorithmic passwords are not susceptible to reuse. That is, a user can type in a password and no entity intercepting that password will be able to reuse it. In this variation, the system and the user share a secret. The secret is never transmitted over a medium that allows exposure. Rather, the secret is used as input to the function along with a shared seed. Then is biometrics. Another variation on the use of passwords for authentication involves the use of biometric measures. Palm or hand readers are commonly used to secure physical access, for example, access to a data center. These readers match stored parameters against what is being read from hand reader pads. The parameters can include a temperature map as well as a finger length, finger width, and line patterns. These devices are currently too large and expensive to be used for normal computer authentication. Fingerprint readers have become accurate and cost-effective and should become more common in the future. These devices read your finger's ridge patterns and convert them into a sequence of numbers. Over time, they can store a set of sequences to adjust for the location of the finger on the reading pad and other factors. Software can then scan a finger on the pad and compare its features with these stored sequences to determine if the finger on the pad is the same as the stored one. Of course, multiple users can have profiles stored and the scanner can differentiate among them. A very accurate two-factor authentication scheme can result from requiring a password as well as a username and fingerprint scan. If this information is encrypted in transit, the system can be very resistant to spoofing or replay attack. Multi-factor authentication is better still. Consider how strong authentication can be with a USB device that must be plugged into the system, a PIN and a fingerprint scan. Except for the users having to place a finger on a pad and plug the USB into the system, this authentication method is no less convenient than using normal passwords. Recall, though, that strong authentication by itself is not sufficient to guarantee the ID of the user. An authenticated session can still be hijacked if it is not encrypted. So, with this, our today's lecture is over. Today, we discussed about operating system, its characteristics, types of operating system, and security issues. I hope you have understood the concepts. In the next lecture, we will discuss about various security policies and other related concepts. Thank you. Have a good day.